So in the wake of the Santa Fe High School shooting a few weeks ago, one of the students interviewed said she was not even surprised when the shooting started. She was only afraid. In her words, it's been happening everywhere, so it's only a matter of time until it happens here. To hear this from the mouth of an American teenager, someone who could have easily been my friend if I was there, is absolutely terrifying. At 16, I should be worried about boys, and paying for my car, and taking the SAT. But when I wake up in the morning, the thoughts weighing heavy on my mind are what class I'll be in when the shooting starts, and which of my friends I'll be holding in my arms, watching the life drain from their eyes. Over 7,000 American children have died from gun violence in the past few years. If 7,000 children died from a toy or a product, action would be taken against it within months. And yet these mass murders have been going on for decades in this country. And they've become a sort of brutal routine. In fact, they often barely even hit the news. But in the wake of Santa Fe High School and the tragedy that happened at Marjory Stoneman Douglas High School, I've realized that I can't and I won't be silent about this, because it truly is the issue of my generation. Despite media portrayals, school shootings aren't simply a gun problem or a mental health problem. They're a multifaceted and dynamic issue and should be combated as such. Banning guns alone won't end school shootings. Talking about mental health won't end school shootings. And changing our conceptualization of masculinity won't end school shootings. But when we start to recognize and combat this issue for what it is, a crisis on every level, then and only then will we begin to see change. And see change we must, because my right to come home from school alive transcends politics. Now, gun laws are the surface of the issue. They close loopholes and keep guns out of the hands of dangerous people. But in our American society, I see some who are more concerned with owning guns than they are with keeping I and my peers alive. When I see someone using a cardboard cutout of the Parkland students as target practice, or tweeting that they have no souls, that's when I know it's time to change our culture around guns. All we want is common sense reform. We want to close the boyfriend loophole and make it harder for mentally ill people to get guns so that firearms are out of the hands of people who are a danger to themselves or others. We want to limit the power of the gun lobby so that we can start to see change on the highest levels of government. And perhaps most importantly, we need to keep guns out of the hands of teenagers and people even younger. The laws in this country surrounding guns are almost laughably lax, except you don't hear me laughing, and neither are the loved ones of those who've been shot. It's common sense. Fewer guns means fewer shootings, and fewer shootings means fewer of us in the ground. Now, gun violence touches on the surface of the issue, who can get and use guns. But what it doesn't do is address the underlying societal problems that breed hate and violence. One such problem is the negative stigma surrounding people who talk about mental health, which is something I have personal experience with. I have anxiety, and I've been through our mental health system both in school and with outside counselors. And with that experience, I can say we have to change the system, and we have to talk about mental health. Because I have incredible privilege. My mental illness isn't as severe or as visible as many, and I've been blessed with a support group of amazing family and friends. But I've still experienced discrimination and been looked down upon because of my mental illness. And that's how I know that we need to change our system. Because in our culture of boys don't cry, this privilege and this attention doesn't extend to everyone. Because we raise nearly half of our society that it's weak and that it's feminine to show emotion, and this is harmful on a basic level, because we all have emotions that we deserve to express. But it's also harmful on a much deeper plane, because men make up 66% of suicides, two-thirds, and yet they're a fraction of the people in counseling, becoming counselors, and talking about mental illness. This is unacceptable, because if we keep parts of our society down simply because of who they are, then we keep all of us down. And for that reason, And because the tie back to shootings is brutally simple, when we have someone who's in the headspace of killing their classmates, more than likely, they're dealing with some type of mental illness. And more than likely, they've fallen through the cracks of a system that doesn't allow people to be human and feel. So that's why we have to talk about mental health. We have to change the system and raise people that it's no worse to have an illness of the brain than it is to have an illness of the heart or the lungs. Mental illness is one small fraction of the disservice we do to men in American society. Male entitlement breeds violence, and American white men are the most entitled demographic on the planet. Statistically, they're also the most likely to be mass shooters. I don't believe in coincidences, and especially not here. Male entitlement kills, and the problem starts at birth. Described under the label of toxic masculinity, this problem is the societal structures, like traditional male gender roles, that limit the range of emotion allowable for men to show to that of aggression and violence. Toxic masculinity is boys will be boys, where we excuse violent and inappropriate behavior simply because of the gender of the child behaving as such. Toxic masculinity is media that shows men as aggressive and power hungry, and women as nothing more than objects for the taking. And toxic masculinity is sexist stereotypes and characters that restrict every member of our society. Any number of factors contribute to toxic masculinity, and toxic masculinity contributes to shootings. A prime example of this is the Santa Fe shooter. You may or may not have heard that he targeted the class of a girl who turned him down for a date, but the real story is so much more insidious than that. He'd stalked this young woman for 4 months, felt so entitled to her, her body, her personality and sense of self, that when she turned him down, something that any one of us has a right to do, she lost her life, and so did 9 other innocent people. When put this way, toxic masculinity doesn't just hurt men. It hurts all of us, and 10 people and countless more have lost their lives because of it. For this reason, we have to talk about it, and we have to take responsibility for this issue in our society. And I know what you might be thinking, not all men are like this. And you're right, not all men are misogynists, not all men beat women, and not all men are school shooters. But the point isn't that all men are like this. The point is that enough men are that it's a problem and we have to treat it as such. Now, because for this reason and for countless other reasons, when we keep one part of our society down and force them into a box, we keep all of us down, and frankly, we keep all of us in danger. Now let's look at the psychological profile of a stereotypical school shooter. More than likely, he won't fit into the box of toxic masculinity, and because of this, he becomes more and more violent and disenchanted with society as a whole. Also, he'll probably have fallen through the cracks of our mental health system and not been able to get the help that he needed, or not been able to even recognize that he had a problem at all. And perhaps, most obviously, he has access to a gun. Now, gun legislation is the surface of the issue. It closes loopholes and keeps guns out of the hands of people who harm themselves and others. But what it doesn't do is touch on the societal problems. It doesn't raise boys and girls the same way, or talk about mental illness, or teach about it in schools. And when we start to truly do that and touch on the societal level of the problem, that's when we begin to nip shootings in the bud. And we must, because I refuse to go to school afraid for my life in a society that can't take responsibility for its issues. And I know also, it's incredibly easy to become discouraged and say, what can I, one person, do to combat an issue that's so huge and so prevalent? And the answer is, I was in the same boat. For months after what happened at Parkland, I was afraid and I was angry. But I'm here, and I have turned my feeling into action. Maybe public speaking isn't how you choose to get involved, but even more importantly than this is what happens on the ground. It's giving a few hours of your time to an organization that advocates for the survivors of gun violence, or it's voting for a candidate who makes the safety of our next generation a top priority. And most importantly, where we truly begin to end this issue is when we start to have difficult conversations with our friends, and our coworkers and the people in our life. Because as we talk about this issue, we keep it in the spotlight, and as we keep it in the spotlight, we begin to breed change. So to conclude, I want to tie back to the theme of this event, which is why not? Much of what I suggest isn't huge or radical. It's simply having a tough conversation or giving a couple hours of your time. So I say, why not? Why not stand up and realize that change is in order? Why not advocate for common sense gun legislation and make it so that we can go to school without being worried about every single person in a long coat or jumping at every noise? And why not talk about mental health? Educate about it. Teach people that this illness and this epidemic affects all of us in one way or another. And why not take responsibility for toxic masculinity? Why not exercise its phrases and mentalities from our societal vernacular? Raise boys and girls the same way. Teach young men that it's not weak or feminine to show emotion. And why not stop using femininity as an insult? I look out across the crowd, and I see a lot of faces I know and a lot I don't. But in this moment, I want to ask us all to rise above individual differences and say, why not? Why not make it so that our next generation lives till graduation? And as a society, why not stand up and start to make the change today? Thank you.